then? Yeah. What's it about when the girls want them?
Well, a few of them want them, but they're not going to get them. Horrible-looking things. Have you seen them?
No, never.
Very dodgy, you know.
Are they?
Yes, very nice.
Let's have another look.
Another look?
Yeah. Open wide this time. Yeah,
cameras, will this affect your performance?
No. 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 Nice and wide.
After you had him out,
we got this one.
After you've had him out, will you do a bit of singing yourself?
Yeah, I'll sing anyway.
Will you?
You haven't been buying the albums, have you?
No, obviously not.
Okay, cut.
Yes, of course. Let's see, why not?
Are you going to stay out of the limelight?
Yes.
Out of your own choice?
Yes.
And what about the family? How many children do you want to have?
About three.
39.
You've all taken. Can I have the story of your romance? Patty, how did it all start?
Well, we met on the set of A Hard Day's Night, and George and the others were filming it, and I was chosen to play a part of a schoolgirl by Dick Lester and Walter Shenson.
Good old Dick Lester and Walter Shenson.
Yes.
Well, I've never been for them.
And take it up from there. What happened then?
Well, actually, I asked Patty out when we were making the film, and she said no, which was very embarrassing at the time, but it all worked out right in the end.
Rage.
When I found myself in distinguished company,
the second time,
and may I, without more ado, introduce George
Hello.
Harrison,
Hello.
MBE.
Thank you.
John Lennon, MBE.
Oh, sorry, yeah.
Ringo Starr, MBE. And Paul McCartney, MBE.
How do you do?
Now, a general question to all you gentlemen, and I must call you gentlemen now. How do you feel, John, about having the MBE?
I feel great. You know, we're honoured. We are, though.
Were you terribly surprised?
Yeah, you know, I mean, everybody was, I think. Well, I think we were the most surprised. Us and Donald Zach.
George,
yeah?
What was your first reaction when you heard you'd been awarded the MBE?
Well, I didn't believe it really at first, but then when they sent me all bits of paper saying that, and you wrote it in the papers, well, you had to believe it. It's great, you know. Didn't expect it at all, you know.
Ringo hasn't told his mum yet.
Is this true, Ringo? You haven't told your mum about this yet?
No, she'll have read about it today, though.
Were you surprised at all?
Yes, very.
When did you first know you'd been awarded the MBE?
2 days ago. We had the form 6 weeks ago to fill in, you know, but we didn't know we'd actually got it until 2 days ago.
Did the form come with the rest of your fan mail, or did it come separately? In a very sort of impressive envelope?
Yes, we all thought it was caller papers. I keep using that line, it's not mine. And but when we opened them, it was, you know, if you'd like to have an MBE, sign here. So we did.
Is that
really? Yes, so we signed our name. Richard Stark, you know. MBE, not Ringo.
Thank you very much.
Still the same Ringo.
Sent two bottle tops and we got it.
Paul, how do you react to having this award?
I think it's great. Marvellous. it is, isn't it? You can't say anything about it.
Do you think you really deserve an award like the MBE?
I don't know, you know. What does it matter? We got it, you know.
Yeah. Doesn't it? You got a medal of the actual MBE. Where will you wear it?
I hope it's on a bit of a tag so you can shove it around your neck, you know, because if it's got a pin, you wreck all your suits. I want a bit of a tab on that.
You've not had a chance to move out of your hotels since you arrived in Australia. You've virtually been locked up.
Yes.
Why is this?
Don't
you want to go out, in other words?
Well, it's not particularly that.
We don't expect to go out, you know, on a tour, really. If we get out, it's just a bit of luck, I'd say.
But you haven't had a chance to go to a party, to see anything
at all. Not a lot of time. If you want to have a party, we're not very keen on parties.
But how do you get to know the people to invite along?
We very seldom have them, and if we do, they're usually people from the show or people that we've met.
John, if you hadn't been a Beatle, or if the Beatles hadn't been successful, what career would you have chosen?
I probably would have been in prison.
What about you, Ringo?
Well, I was an engineer for 4 years. I must have still be there, slogging away.
You wouldn't have turned to writing, John, would you?
No.
I wouldn't have written John.
No.
Mass reaction from a crowd like you had here in Melbourne today really worry you? Do you regard it as social misbehaviour, or do you still...
No.
Boo.
No.
Boo.
No.
Go on.
No, it's great. We love it. You know, it's good.
We've been told not to turn round, you see.
Oh.
It's a bit mad. We've got to look this way and talk to him.
Do you think you started this fashion, or was this fashion already coming in and you adopted it?
It's a few years older than us, actually.
No, we don't reckon the...
Caesar had it.
Yeah.
Remember him? Little fella.
Yeah. Napoleon.
Lions.
What about on tour? Do you have to get a haircut at all?
We never have to.
If you feel like, that is. You
do it annoying around the ears and things.
Are you interested in sport at all?
No.
What about
swimming, you know.
That's sport.
Do you think you're religious?
The way we swim. Are we religious?
No.
No, actually.
Do you think the effect that you have on teenagers is a good, healthy effect?
Good, yes.
Yeah. Well, it's not bad, you know. I mean,
there's been no cases of it being bad, so it must probably be good, I think.
Is it to any extent a calculated effect, or is this an effect that's just come naturally to each and every one of you?
I think it's sort of snowballed. It's more natural. It's more natural than, you know, it's not calculated.
Can we ask you to amplify the point, then, how this hysteria generates? Nobody seems to be able to put their finger on a reason why. It seems to be a combination of things. What do you believe it is?
Yeah, well, exactly that.
In an audience at any rock and roll concert, there's always, when we first started, nobody really knew us, there's always a section that scream at everybody. And then if the others like it as well, they'll join in.
Is Paul McCartney alive, or was born on the 18th of June 1942 in Liverpool? Now at the age of 27, he is either a millionaire Beatle with a beautiful wife, or he's dead and has been for about 2 years. According to the rumours, he is supposed to have died in a car crash in 1966. The controversy surrounding Paul McCartney was recently the subject of an hour-long report on radio. 5AD's Martin Smith presents the evidence.
Started in Detroit, a group of university students were playing tapes backwards and forwards, different speeds. They gave their evidence to a disc jockey in Detroit. His name was Russ Gibb, and together, collectively, they thought Paul McCartney had died. I understand they still do. So people throughout the world then started to think, well, what has happened? The Beatles have made no live appearances for 3 years. There have been no records for a certain period of time in 1966. When Paul was supposed to have died, I understand he went to Africa at the time, but maybe he did have an accident of some sort. Anyway, the first record that came out after the lull of activity from Apple Records was Strawberry Fields Forever, which I understand Strawberry Fields is a graveyard on a hillside in Liverpool. Other people have told me it's an orphanage down the road from where John Lennon lived, but I think we're both right. I think if they check up as well, Strawberry Fields is definitely a cemetery overlooking Liverpool. The first LP to come out about the same time as Strawberry Fields was the Sgt. Pepper album. The cover of this, as well as some of the songs on it, is very interesting. If you look at the minute detail which is on there, you can find that the Beatles are actually gathered around what looks like a grave. This could be the grave they buried them old Sound of Music in, but it could be the grave that they buried Paul in. He's standing head and shoulders above the rest. He's meant to be a lot shorter. Around his wax model from Madame Tussauds are heads of Marlon Brando, who met a tragic death in The Wild One, and also Tom Mix, and he died in a car accident. On the back of the album, Paul has his back to us. On the inside photos, the initials OPD are on his arm. Does that mean, oh, Paul is dead? There's a guitar with left-handed strings, left-handed guitar on the around the grave. He was a left-handed four-string guitarist. So there you are, it goes from one thing to the other. And also, musically on the record, at the very end, when the needle is running over the dead surface area, waiting to be taken back by the arm, well then there's a little bit there which caught our attention, and it could be, will Paul be back as Superman? Forwards, it doesn't sound like anything too much, but perhaps backwards, that does come out. There are certain things on the Magical Mystery Tour album as well, visually and music-wise, which proved interesting. For instance, you can look at some of the photos. We were just mentioning Superman. There's a photo in there of Paul as Superman, with Superman at the driving wheel. Paul thought he was the driver. There's also a couple of shots of Paul without his shoes on, which is the mark of a corpse in Italy. His shoes are to the side of him. And the last album, which has been released here in Australia, the Abbey Road album, probably musically, we haven't been able to find too much yet. People have read certain things into certain tracks so far. But certainly the cover is rather fascinating. You have the four Beatles walking across Abbey Road, which is where the EMI recording studios are in London, where they record. John Lennon is dressed as a religious figure. Following him is Ringo. He's dressed as an undertaker. Then you've got McCartney. He's out of step and barefoot and dressed in a normal suit, the mark of the corpse again. And then follows up George Harrison as a kind of hippie gravedigger dressed in jeans. Whether this has any significance, I don't know. My theory is, for what it's worth, that Paul was close to dying at some stage. And now, when it's all over and he is better, they, and especially John Lennon, who is known to have this cynical mind, can look back on it and make one big joke out of it. I told you about the war as a mean man. You know that we're as close as can be, man. Well, here's another clue for you all. The walrus was Paul.
Rage. Rage. Try to see it my way.
Have you a tribute that you'd like to pay to Mr. Epstein?
Oh, you know, we don't know what to say. We loved him, and he was one of us. So you can't, you know...
You can't pay tribute in words. What are your plans now?
To return to London and do whatever we can.
Did the Maharishi give you any words of comfort?
Yes, well, his meditation gives you confidence enough to withstand something like this, even the short amount we've had.
And then the thing that we've got to know about, there's no real such thing as death anyway. I mean, it's death on a physical level, but life goes on everywhere and you just keep going, really. So the thing is, it's not as disappointing as it is and it isn't, you know. And there's a thing about the comfort is to know that he's okay.
I understand that this afternoon Maharishi conferred with you all. Could I ask you what advice he offered you?
He told us not to get overwhelmed by grief and to whatever thoughts we have about him, to keep them happy.